was a great introduction to PASCO Live. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to PASCO Live. Brett, what are you doing?
I'm here to learn the science of rock and roll.
Well, you definitely came to the right place, because this is PASCO Laboratories, this is PASCO Live. We'll be able to answer your questions live. We've got somebody standing by to answer them. And Brett, we're even going to help you learn some things today, too.
I sure hope so.
The one thing that everybody always asks me, Brett, is, what does the P stand for?
I don't know. What does the P stand for today,
I'm
JP?
Going to tell you, right. Today, the P actually stands for proportional.
Ooh, that's a very
important word.
And do
you know why it stands for proportional? Because almost all the relationships of your device and music have some type of proportional relationship, and we're going to demonstrate them. We're going to demonstrate that frequency is inversely proportional to the length of the string.
That makes sense, because when I fret a note and I change the length of the vibrating string to be shorter,
the note
goes higher.
So you see that there's a relationship there, and we're actually going to show you what that relationship is, and we're going to prove that proportionality. But that's just one thing you're going to learn today, Brett.
What else?
We're also going to teach you that frequency is proportional to the square root of the tension.
Ah.
There's a relationship of tension and frequency.
Okay, so if I take a string and I increase the tension, the frequency goes up.
That's right. And so there's a proportional relationship there, and we're going to learn that relationship. And there's one more thing, Brett. I mean, there's a ton of stuff that you're going to learn, but you're going to learn that the frequency is inversely proportional to the square root of the linear density.
Now,
I know that doesn't make like a whole lot of sense right away.
It makes sense to me.
Does it?
It does.
What does that mean?
Because each string is a different thickness, therefore linear density.
That's correct.
And so the thinner strings have a smaller linear density than the thicker strings, which have a higher linear density.
So that has something to do with the frequency.
Yes.
And we're going to learn about that. So Brett, we could talk about these proportionalities, but what you really want to do is learn about these proportionalities.
Absolutely.
And so what I'm going to do is introduce you to a new device that PASCO just recently designed and released, and it's called the new PASCO Sonometer. Ladies and gentlemen, it's the Sonometer.
It looks like a very weird guitar.
It is in many ways, but I think what you're going to find out is that this has some capabilities beyond your guitar. And to better help us understand these capabilities, we're going to bring in Sonometer expert, our own local talent in physics, Mr. Dan Burns. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Dan Burns. Welcome, Dan.
Well, Brett, you know, the PASCO electric guitar sure is fun, but so is the new PASCO Sonometer, and it can do some things that your guitar can't do.
Like what?
Show us,
well,
Dan. I'm going to let you teach Brett some things.
Let me show you. Well, we've only got two strings, and they attach here at the end.
Okay.
And we have these tuning pegs.
I have those.
Now, to tension it, though, I hang a mass here.
Okay.
And I can measure that tension.
Mm.
So I know exactly what it is, because this lever arm here is 5 times what it is for the string.
Okay.
So whatever weight I put here, the tension is five times
the mass. Okay.
If this tensioning lever is horizontal.
Okay.
So there's a built-in bubble level. If you just adjust that other way, I think.
Okay.
Nope, you had it right.
Okay.
Keep going. Once the bubble level says this is level, then we know the tension. A little bit more.
Keep going.
There you go. Perfect.
All right.
Now, the other limits.
How much mass do you have hanging off of
that? I have 1 kilogram.
Okay.
So it's about 10 newtons. So the tension in the string is 5 times 10, 50 newtons, about 47 if you want to be.
Okay.
49 if you want to be tricky here. I can put up to 3 kilograms on that. And so that'd be almost 150 newtons of tension that I can, and I'll know precisely what it is. The other thing I can do is vary the length of the string to any length I want. And there's a built-in scale that tells me what that length is.
Let's play a song.
That I can't do. So when students are given an instrument like this, they can investigate the science of sound and oscillation.
And that's why I am here today.
So one activity they could do is fix the tension, and then they can set the length of the string, in this case 0.45 meters, and they know the wavelength because both ends of the string are fixed.
Mm-hmm.
So the wavelength is twice the length of the string.
Right, that's the 1 over 2L, which is frequency inversely proportional to 1 over twice the length.
So we know the wavelength is 0.9 meters, and when they pluck it with the supplied PASCO guitar pick...
Ooh, I don't have one of those.
These are popular items around the office.
I need one of those.
You can measure the frequency. There are a couple of different ways of doing that.
And you can hear it. You can hear it.
You can definitely hear it.
And I think that's important for students also to hear the difference in the pitch.
And one way to measure the frequency is with the wireless PASCO sound sensor. So I am monitoring the frequencies it's measuring with this FFT display on PASCO capstone.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we have all this noise in the room, so it's also picking that up.
Let me, I can quiet that down.
I thought it was mainly me talking.
No,
it's hard
it's loud guitar amps. That's what they do.
If you pluck that, we'll see if we can measure the frequency. One more time. It's getting a lot of noise in here. We did this before.
Go.
Let's try one more time.
Okay.
And so I know from experience it's this one right here. And so very quickly, I can measure the frequency of the string as long as there's not a rock band in the classroom, which usually there isn't. Now, there's another way you can measure the frequency without the sound sensor. In this case, we would set the frequency to be equal to whatever this tuning fork is, and then we adjust the length until it matches the tuning fork frequency, and we know that from resonance.
Mm.
Now, you might be able to hear it, but to help, we put these little paper riders, we call them. It's just a little thin piece of paper in a V shape, so it hangs on the string. And then when I strike the tuning fork and hold it on the plate of the sonometer, and move it until I see them move. And just to check it, let's do that again. Sometimes they even hop right, there they go. That one hopped right off. So now I know this length and wavelength corresponds to the frequency of the tuning fork. So now I can take my analysis tools and graph the wavelength versus the frequency, and I'd see there's a curve to it.
Okay.
But if I graph the wavelength versus 1 over the frequency, I get a linear relationship, and they can even find out that the slope of that line is the speed of the transverse wave in the string.
That's excellent.
All that just with that part of this instrument.
And that would be
hard
to do on a guitar.
It would be.
It's so much easier with this.
Now, the other part is to vary the tension.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can fix the wavelength, doesn't matter what you decide to fix it at, measure a frequency, then add tension, readjust the level each time. Keep going, there you go, right there.
Okay.
And then measure the new frequency, and you can keep doing that, get 5 or 6 points.
Right.
And then now you can graph the frequency versus, or the tension versus the frequency.
Okay.
And then it's not linear, but if you play around with it, you'd find out the tension versus the frequency squared is linear for people that like to have their students linearize things.
And we know physics teachers do.
Right. Now we have this other string. So one thing we can do is make the tensions the same.
And what's
and
what
the
is
wavelengths
this other string?
The same. And so the string out in front here is thicker. It has a gauge. You know, you probably know string gauges.
Yeah.
It's 0.018, which is, I guess, the diameter in inches, but most people wouldn't care about that, but we might, right? And then this other one, the thinner one, is 0.014. And so if you play them both, you can see the thinner one does produce a higher frequency.
Yep, absolutely.
So they can also find out that the, as we were saying, the linear mass density is involved in this, and they can create a graph and measure the linear mass density of those strings.
Excellent.
Now, the thing I was playing around with this morning is, so that's a low frequency, higher frequency. Mm-hmm. I can adjust the thinner string, the smaller diameter one, so it matches that frequency.
Okay.
So I could do it by hearing. But I'm not very good at that. You might be able to do it. But the paper writers come back in, and I can use resonance. So not only can I hear it, but I can see it.
Yeah, this one's a lot higher. So I think it's going to go that way.
Oh, it's the other way.
Yeah, there you go.
And so what I found is the ratio of the wavelengths was the inverse of the ratio of the gauges.
Hmm. There we go.
There we go.
There we go.
I switched the two. The one I use are on the other side. So I learned something about the physics of guitars just by playing around with the sonometer. I hope you've learned something as well, Brett.
I definitely have. Thank you, Dan.
Awesome. Dan, that was terrific. And I'm assuming, Brett, you picked up this proportional idea of the relationships. And your folks can pick up these proportional relationships also. It's easy. You don't need a rock star, and you don't need a rocket scientist. All you need is the PASCO sonometer. Now, Dan, if you wanted to do other experiments that related to sound, is there another device that you could use in conjunction with this or might be able to use to help you understand this?
This is for string instruments, but you could use our resonance air column to understand how other musical instruments work as well.
So whether it be the air type of instruments,
like a trumpet,
or a saxophone, or the string type of instruments, like a guitar, you can learn just using some very simple equipment that you can find right here and bring it into your classrooms. Brett, do you have any questions?
I think we've covered it all, JP.
Dan, you did a great job, and we really thank you guys for joining us. But what we'd like to close with today is a competition, kind of like dueling machines. Let's see if you guys can take us out as we wish you all at home the best of luck, great teaching, and good day. I leave it to you.